Our guest today is Dr. Kaifala Marrah. He is the Minister of Finance and Economic Development.
Thank you.
Before his appointment as Minister, he was the champion of the Extractive Industries Transparency Initiative in Sierra Leone. Good morning, Dr. Marrah.
Thank you. Good morning.
Today, we shall be talking about Sierra Leone's unsuccessful attempt at getting the validation of the EITI, as well as the broader issues concerning the economy of Sierra Leone.
Thank you.
Dr. Marrah, Sierra Leone has been a candidate country of the EITI since February 2008. During the launch of the validation report last year, you were very optimistic about the chances of Sierra Leone being validated. We all now know that the exact opposite happened. What went wrong?
Thank you so much for having me on this program. Let me just bring in a little correction. And Sierra Leone's being part of the EITI process, it didn't really happen in 2008. It predates 2008. It started, I think, 2004, 2005. Now, I came in as chief of staff, I think in the latter part of 2010, and I was given the mandate to manage the EITI process. But let me just reiterate that we had failed the EITI process then, but then Sierra Leone was meant to go again for another evaluation. But there is an element here to note, that Sierra Leone was going to evaluate itself for 2008, 2009, and 2010, three straight years. And this was happening in 2012. And if you take a look at the audit report of only 2011, it tells you that records management is weak, and that particularly so in terms of the way, not how resources are managed, but how they are even entered. But there is a need for me to take you through as to how the process was. The EITI, which is the Extractive Industries Transparency Initiative, is an international initiative that requires countries, particularly that are in the mineral sector, to do two things. One, that for a particular reporting period, government or revenue agencies within government should be able to report what they have so far received from the mining companies. And mining companies, on the other hand, will also have to report on what taxes or royalties they have paid to those institutions. Now, these two figures are reconciled by a reconciler, which should be recruited externally. The reconciler will reconcile these numbers and show where discrepancies are, and then be able to make recommendations so that the government of the country may be able to take actions regarding those discrepancies. Now, in Sierra Leone, there are many agencies, the NRA, the Ministry of Mines, local councils, as well as disparate number of small to medium mining companies or exploration companies, as well as bigger ones. What happened was, in this case, that the NRA or many revenue agencies in the country were meant to open their books from the period 2008, 2009, and 2010. And this was happening in 2012. And mining companies also reported during the same period. Now, when the numbers were reconciled, the discrepancy was about $8 million. And so I decided that we should go back to the basics. Enthusiastic though I was, and I still am about it, I made sure that I rolled my sleeves and got involved in the process. I worked assiduously with the NRA. Now, I'm not a tax officer. I was chief of staff, working in the office of the president, worked with mining companies, worked around the clock along with my team and the SPU. At the end of the day, we were able to bring down the discrepancy to about $1 million or so. But Sierra Leone didn't fail outrightly. Before I came on the ground, Sierra Leone had made some progress, but there were many requirements outstanding. Now, there are 18 requirements to be met, and a country must pass all of them. During this case, when I led the whole process, Sierra Leone passed 16, with the exception of only two. And those two were one, there was some form of a misunderstanding between government as well as the validator. Now, we had an external individual come from that came to evaluate what the reconciler had done. Now, not only did we do a supplementary report through which we were able to reconcile the numbers and break down the discrepancies to about a million, but that we were able to pass 16 requirements, many of them tough and difficult. Now, for the two outstanding requirements that we are not able to meet were the following. One, as I said, there was some misunderstanding, particularly on definition of materiality. But materiality is, in simple, what do you constitute? How much money do you constitute to be of material value to be considered for reconciliation? So for them, they felt that we didn't get that right. But I think we did. Because according to the rules, it really is the responsibility of the MSG, the multi-stakeholder group, to be able to determine that. But in my view, the validators feel Sierra Leone on that.
Let's talk about the validator. The validator produced a report which was taken to the EITS secretariat, and a board sees and reads that report. How come that the board could not see that the validator was biased against Sierra Leone?
Because in his view, certain payments or certain materiality should have been a little above what happened. Mm-hmm. But the challenge we had was simple. Mm-hmm. One, that he should have taken into consideration that many of the exploration companies did come and go. They'll come and go because a good number of them weren't doing well. I can, for example, cite one called a Chinese company called Shenfeng, mm-hmm. that came on the ground and disappeared. And I went to the extent of even writing a letter to the Chinese ambassador here to Sierra Leone, even had a follow-up meeting with the ambassador. But the company wasn't here anymore. Now, how could you then hold a country accountable for a company that came into a country 3 or 4 years back and left without really doing anything? The company didn't do anything. They didn't mind, they didn't do anything. So you shouldn't, in real terms, hold a country culpable for that. I think what should have happened was to have listened to the ministry officials to explain clearly how it happened. Now, but as I said, I only did my best to ensure that this was done. Now, the other element, and this is important, which and this is also about the materiality that I wish you know, was that the audit reports of many of the mining companies, they didn't meet international auditing standards. That they should have been certified internationally. Now that didn't happen. Mm-hmm. So what I did was to do my best to ensure that compliance is possible, and we did make progress in that. But I think we have learned lessons from those. It meant, therefore, that those companies should have to ensure that their reports henceforth should meet international auditing standards. And secondly, that local councils are able to report.
I'll come to the question of local councils, but let's look at revenue collection agencies you talked about, the NRA, the Ministry of Finance. We all know that the NRA has principal responsibility to raise revenue for the government of Sierra Leone, but there are reports that some mining companies pay money directly to the Ministry of Finance, some pay directly to the Ministry of Mineral Resources, some pay to the NRA. And to what extent, the second question following that, to what extent did you use the MCAS system at the Ministry of Mineral Resources? Because the Mining Cadastre Administration system has reports over financial payments by mining companies as far back as 2008. So that would have been a simple tool to have used to get all the information that you needed, whether or not a mining company was in Sierra Leone.
You know, my view has always been that it really would be useful for people to read a lot more about the EITI process and how it evolved, because people normally get it wrong. Two things. One, Ministry of Finance does not collect revenue directly. We don't. That is not our core responsibility. The NRA falls on our mandate, our purview, and so they do that. Now, they say that some mining companies pay directly, they pay directly to the CRF, the Consolidated Revenue Fund, at the central bank, not to Ministry of Finance. That is one. And the second element is the cadastral system. Now, what you need to know is that the cadastral system in the Ministry of Mines and Mineral Resources is first amongst its kind in the sub-region. There is no country that has been able to match the progress we have made in terms of being open and transparent in the mineral sector. The mining cadastral system that we have provides information and data on many of the mining companies. Now, that is evolving. It really is evolving. Now, it is evolving, and so therefore, you cannot go there one morning. You can only have information, particularly on the number of companies. Now, there are also various levels of company engagement in a country. You may have companies that are only here to explore alone. There are other companies that are developing. There are other companies that are at production stage. So there is a varying facet of activities within the mining sector. So the cadastral system is not adequate to be able to provide every relevant data that you may wish to be able to capture, to become transparent, or to be able to report in the EITI process. What it does is it brings value to the whole environment such that it aids the relevant agencies to be able to make the right decision. Now, but the truth is, the mining cadastral system that we have is the best in the sub-region, and that has helped us a lot.
Okay, the final question on that note would be the local councils. What is the significant, or how significant is the funds that the local councils receive that could impact the result of the validation process for Sierra Leone? Because mining companies do not pay monies directly to local councils. So if local councils fail to report revenues that they get through mining revenues, for example, through the DACDF, etc., how that could that have seriously impacted the outcome of our validation process?
Okay, now, what Sierra Leone did was to be as open and transparent as possible. We had the choice to restrict reporting at central government level. But what we decided to do was to open the scope as widely as possible, such that in the near future, local councils here, I mean chiefdom administration, will be able to report effectively. It really is not of any substantial amount to have skewed the whole process. But what really is required here is for them to be able to report, and that was why we decided to involve them. Now, the question that you and I have to answer is, would you, given the way situations are, expect local councils, chiefdom administration, far-flung institutions away from the center, to have been able to save receipts for 2008, 2009, and 2010 and be able to report on them? Even when the case is within central government that institutions fail to do so? The ideal situation will be yes, but the reality is no. And that is why, under my poor view, or my insofar as I think as a new Minister of Finance, is that we should institute fiscal discipline and go by the books, such that institutions, no matter what level they are, should be able to do that which is required of them and do that which is right.
Let's go to the agenda for prosperity for a minute. Pillar 2 of the Agenda for Prosperity, which is basically about the management of mining
natural resources.
Of natural resources. And accountability and transparency of the management of our mining revenues is critical to achieving Pillar 2.
Yeah.
And that is also the core of the EITI process. Now, we have been suspended. We still have to submit some report, which will be considered down the road. What do you think the suspension of Sierra Leone within the context of the EITI would mean to the government of Sierra Leone as well as to the Agenda for Prosperity?
Okay, there is an element here I really wish that you note. Being suspended, temporarily suspended, doesn't take Sierra Leone out of the process.
Oh, yes, sure.
The new chief of staff and the team are currently working on those two anomalies to ensure that they are quickly corrected and done with. But what we have done as a country is to even go beyond the EITI process. The EITI process requires you to report only. Now, what government is doing here is to say, okay, fine. Under our minerals resources, opportunity that we have that will, you know, create boom for us in the future, we need to create what we call a transformation fund, such that a certain percentage of every royalty or taxes paid in this sector are sent to that pot. Those resources could be used to transform our human resource capacity, invest in investment, you know, go for infrastructure or health or social services to be able to transform the country. Now, that is a brilliant way of going about it, even beyond the prescriptions of the EITI. The EITI is saying, report what you receive, publish it. Now, government is saying, irrespective of being able to publish what is there, we want to be prudent about the resources that we receive. Let us establish this board. Let us put money there and ensure that we invest in transformation. So that is one element. Now, what we are working on right now is to identify the fiscal rule that will guide us in terms of how much resources will be put there and how it will be used. Now, do not forget that at the end of the Sierra Leone conference, a citizens committee or bureau was established. Now, what will you wish we do? At the end of the day, government will have to be open to the rest of the public to say, this is what the transformation fund is doing. This is how much we have received, and this is how we are doing it. Now, the EITI isn't there yet. This is the beauty of what we are doing. We are saying that not only will we establish a port where some of these resources will go, but that we'll be able to report to the public what we are doing with those resources. We are moving ahead of the EITI process. And according to our strengthened approach under the EITI, government is doing it such a way that we'll be leading other nations in this. Because if you take a look, there is no nation within the sub-region that has gone this way. And we really intend to go as far as possible in ensuring that we cash in more in this area and be able to transform our country.
We'll come back to the TDF, the Transformation and Development Fund, for a minute. But if we as a country could not meet the 18 requirements of the standards, meaning we are not 100% open and transparent, what confidence do or should Sierra Leoneans have that if a TDF is established, the government would be really open and transparent in the management of those resources?
I think you really are missing one element here. Mm-hmm. The country reported everything. And the beauty is, it demonstrated that there were discrepancies. Mm-hmm. What the country is doing is ensuring that they put strategies in place such that these discrepancies may not recur any longer, i.e. that local councils report, that mining companies ensure that their audit report meets international standards. Mm-hmm. Now, these two elements are very significant, but if you take a look at the 16 passes, there are elements there that are far more significant. So we were not particularly delisted.
Oh yeah, sure.
Fine, as other nations. And I don't want to go into naming other nations because this may be viewed by the rest of the world for integrity reasons. But for us in Sierra Leone, all we need to do is just address these two issues and we are fine. Now what they are saying is, you have made significant progress. And if you take a look at the report, it is there. But they would wish that Sierra Leone meets these two requirements to be able to be compliant. Now, to be compliant only means that you have done what they will require you to do. But that doesn't mean that you are not doing the right thing. This is what I wish you to do, to note. What they want Sierra Leone to do is to ensure that these remaining requirements are met within a very short period of time, noting that we have made tremendous progress. Now, you may ask, for the MCC, the Millennium Challenge Corporation, there are about 20 indicators. We've been failing since 2004-05. In 2012, we are able to hit 12, above many countries in the sub-region. We are not given a treasure, we are given a compact. So we scored 12 out of 20. But we passed. In the EITI, they are saying that you need to pass all. 16 passed. They're encouraging Sierra Leone to only make the remaining two. But that does not preclude Sierra Leone from doing that which is right. So I'm saying we are even going in many other areas over and beyond the EITI requirement. The cadastral system, as I mentioned, is the best in this sub-region. The establishment of the transformation is innovative. It's also new within the sub-region. So there are many more initiatives that the country has embarked upon that are way and far beyond the EITI requirement. That is what I want to underscore.
But clearly the validation of Sierra Leone is critical for
that will be done within a short period of time.
Issues. And the question here is September 31st is the deadline for us to submit our report. And this is clearly or will be our last shot at getting validated and be a compliant country. I know you're no longer the champion of the EITI, but what do you think should be done now to ensure that Sierra Leone does not miss out and we are not delisted?
I think we've done 98% of it. Only two more things that could be done easily. I don't see it as
if you think they were easy to be done, why didn't we do them?
You are making the same mistake as others are doing. You are asking me to get companies' audit report for 2008 to have met international standards in 2012. How could I have done that? You know,
Burkina Faso, they are candidate country.
They are candidate country.
Yeah.
But we are doing far more better than many of them.
But they are candidate country.
Yeah.
Okay. Let's shift a little bit to the economy of Sierra Leone. You are the new Minister of Finance and Economic Development. Talking about the transformation fund, what management system do you think our country should put in place to ensure that the TDF, if set up, up and running, would be managed properly?
Now, what I would like you to note is that the president of Dr. Ernest Bai Koroma is an inclusive and participatory one. First, we are trying to establish a fiscal rule, and as I said, the fiscal rule will set out the parameters within which this fund will be operated. Secondly, there is a citizens' bureau that is drawn from a plethora of sections of society that will be part of the process. They'll all be part of the process. And thirdly, what you need to know is this particular thing is an innovation. It really is not present within the sub-region. And as I said, we are moving ahead of the curve, ahead of other nations. So how it may shape at the end of the day will depend on the input of each and every player. So at the end of the day, we'll have something that is people-owned as well as, you know, government-supported. So that is how we want to go about it. I cannot here sit as a minister and say this is how it will go. It meant that I'll be putting my imprint on it. It shouldn't happen like that. It should be inclusive as well as participatory.
Now, clearly, that would have an impact on our normal or government budgetary system. So what you're suggesting here is that we have parallel structures. We have the consolidated fund, our budgetary system, where revenues definitely will have to go into it to meet to run government's business. At the same time, you have the TDF. What implication would the establishment of the TDF have on the normal budgetary process?
It depends on which side of the fence you stand. Now, a school of thought will say, you cannot be innovative as much as possible if you put everything in a single pot. And what you and I want is to ensure that the people of this country know what is happening to mineral resources and how they are being utilized. That was why I said that we're even moving ahead of the EITI process. It meant that you and I will be able to know a percentage that is being crystallized in a particular pot for transformation. What is it that government is doing with it? It's a way of helping country as well as government to sit down, identify what is there and what it could be useful. There are many trust funds, for example, that are established across governments for specific reasons. What we have here is a special fund for transformation. That is well captured. Now, all of this sits within government. And I don't think there will be any confusion, because at the moment, What I'm trying to do as Minister of Finance is to ensure that we establish a single treasury account, such that no matter how many accounts we have in government, there will be a pseudo account that captures all. So there will be no problem.
That is exactly the reason why I put this question to you, Mr. Minister. Because as Minister of Finance, you have the responsibility to manage our state's resources. Yeah. Therefore, you should have an idea about how you will manage two parallel budgetary processes, basically. Because the Transformation and Development Fund will meet. It will not, the money that you're talking about in the Transformation and Development Fund will not go through the normal budgetary process, would it?
It will be a subset of it, because let me explain. Because in crafting, for example, our budget for a particular period, we'll say X amount of capital project or social project could be done through use of the resources from the Transformation Fund. Why? Because it helps government and citizens to be able to know what we are doing with our resources. It helps us, to checkmate. It helps us to look inwardly and see how best we are doing with those resources. Now, that is a risk if we integrate everything into a single pot. You may not know, for example, how well we are doing in terms of managing our mineral resources. Now, that is a question. That is an element that I would like you to know. Do we, for example, utilize all of these resources for our generation alone? If you integrate everything, that is the risk you are running. Now, what we are saying is, no, forget it, establish a core. And then begin to ask, do you, for example, invest those resources for the next generation? Or do you just utilize it now? So what we are saying is, as a government and as a people, we have to be innovative in terms of how you use resources that accrues from the mineral sector.
Now, the concern here, I'm talking about next generation, saving for next generation. Does that mean that the money that would be in this pot, the TDF pot, would be like a savings account for my kids and grandkids, meaning the government of Sierra Leone would
that
not use
that?
That
was a concern to you. I raised it. Like I told you, it really is useful to engage and re-engage so you know what is happening. Mm-hmm. I just told you of a fiscal rule. A fiscal rule that set the parameters through which these resources could be used. Now, those fiscal rules would clearly articulate when and how these resources could be used, how it could be tracked, why the people need to know. That is the beauty of it. The question is, you cannot just open savings account for kids yet unborn or yet to be born. You can't. But then you ask yourself, how will you invest in the next generation? Will you, for example, establish an ICT village? You understand? Will you, for example, invest more, for kindergarten schools? Will you, for example, pour huge amount of money in the free healthcare? Or could you just ensure that our reserves grow and grow such that our economy will continue to be supported in the interest of the next generation? Or could you say, let us say, X amount of money just as reserve such that the next generation could be able to use it as and when they require. So those resources could not be touched now. But how much would that constitute? That is why I said, when the fiscal rule is concluded, all of us, you and I, and those listening, will have a clear idea as to what the Transformation Fund is about. And I must say this, that there is no country within the sub-region that has gone this far. We are going that way because President Koroma says he wants to do more and we have to get it right.
Now, my last question would be this. We have budget deficit, right?
Yeah.
Saving money from mineral revenues, which is like an engine that would drive our economic growth, would not do good to closing the gap of our budget deficit. Does that not defeat any good argument there may be for setting up an account, a separate account that would not go through the normal government budgetary process?
You know, it depends on where you're coming from, your school of thought that you belong to. Someone will say yes to what you're saying. Others on the other side will say, well, hang on a minute. Maybe we can do it differently. We may use some of it to close the budget deficit. But then there is a need to invest in the future. So there are many ways. There is no one strategy around it. What is required is for achieving, what is clear is for individuals to sit around the table take a look at the whole parameters and ask, what are the best possible choices for Sierra Leone? And those choices, I can assure you, are those that we'll be able to meet. And we will.
Thank you very much, Dr. Marrah.
I want to thank you for having me. Thank you. Yeah.
We have just spoken to Dr. Kaifala Marrah, Minister of Finance and Economic Development for the government of Sierra Leone.